Whatever subject you take, there is a part of the group which doesn't have a background in it, right? So it's nice that you have joined such a course. That is a good thing. It is also nice that he is willing to teach you, right? So whatever the topic is, like, part of you don't have a background in that. So it's good that way. And there is a reason why I am particularly appreciative of this interdisciplinarity, because I believe I have tried to be interdisciplinary myself. Now what do I do? My profession is, I am a farmer who depends on lands to earn my living. So that's how I am a farmer. I stay in a village, I don't stay in the city. So my family is in a very different setting. My kids study in a village. So that's a farmer. Then I do research. I'm a biologist by training in college, so I do research. You must have visited IISc, Indian Institute of Science. Their research station is located on my farm. So I am in charge of the research station. So I do research. That is the second thing. Third thing, I also own a company. We do consulting. We have both within India and outside India consultancy. So I run a company, and my association with this company is as a consultant. So this is not my farm, but this is a farm I have developed. My own farm is 200 kilometers away. Okay. I thought it is a big strain for you to come there. So I have taken you to your farm, which I have developed. So, what do we do today in the next 3 to 4 hours? First is, I'll spend about 40 minutes trying to give you an overview of what you are going to see. This is the background for what you are going to see. Now, what are you going to see today? You see, farming, like you think of business, is a way to make profit, right? Why do I do farming? I don't do farming to feed the world. I do farming to make money, right? I need to survive. My family income depends on it. Just like you guys go to your company and work, we go to the farming to make a living. So farming is about profit. Now, what am I trying to show you today is that in the bus, when we were traveling, remember I showed you some land which depends simply on rain? Now, that land, let us say, makes X amount of rupees, which depends on rain, right? X. Now, here is a model where if they are making X, you can make anywhere between 5X to 10X. Get it? 5 to 10 times more you can make under the same circumstances. Now, is it not a good thing to increase your profits to that level? So we are not talking of 40% increase, 50% increase. We are talking of 500 to 1000% increase. Now this is what we would like to show you. Now to me, though it may sound a bit of an exaggeration, to me this is not a discussion point, because in about 80 acres here, we have achieved it. Once you have achieved it, I am justified in telling I don't want to discuss whether it is possible or not. See, once you have done it, you are welcome to come and see it. You are welcome to evaluate it. Okay. So this 5x to 10x today is validated by the chief financial officer of the company. Now it has entered his books that he is able to get that much of returns. We have taken to that level. Now that is an example I want you to see. Now this big increase in profit has been made possible with a lot of science behind it. Why is it possible? So what I'm going to take you through in the next 40 minutes is the why part of it. There is no, as I said, we are not going to debate whether it will work or not, because it has already worked. We are going to visit it and see it. So that is that part. Now, you must also understand why it works. That is the why that I am going to take you through. And when I take you through, obviously I believe you are all very smart people. So I am going to take you through on a very big range of things. I want to cover a lot of things. So when you want to cover a lot of things, what do? You take a high level view. You know, you are at 30,000 feet. So I will be flying at 30,000 feet. Okay. Whenever you want, if you want more details, you bring me down to 5,000. You ask a question, I stop. If something is not clear, I'll definitely explain. So we will be flying at 30,000. If you want, you bring me down to 5,000. Okay. So the idea is to make you familiar with the concepts behind it. And remember, each of the things that I talk to you today, you are actually going to see it in the field. Okay. Questions also can be asked in the field, right? It is just the background. So the real show is in the field. Okay. So this is to prepare you, to give you the background what you are going to see. So I have told you about myself. Then, this you can skip, this is not meant for you. Okay, this is what we are going to discuss. Okay, and we are going to discuss details, we are going to look at methodology, how it was done. We are also going to look at larger issues than this farm. Now this was just, let's skip that. Now, you are able to see this clearly? Yeah. I will just step away so that you see, whatever I have done is a work of over 20 years. I have spent a lot of time doing it. And this is a combination of research and experience. Not just research, experience. I work with a number of researchers. These are my collaborators. I work with all of them. Then I also work with computer simulation modeling groups. You know, in computer, you make simulation models. I work with a group in Australia and work with one in US. So this is these are the collaborators. And on the research side, I have worked with a number of farm NGOs as well as companies. So it is a collaborative work, what we are trying to do. Then, see, most of you are not familiar with India. Unlike in the US, India depends on monsoons. You have been in the war game, you have understood that the rainfall varies from year to year, right? This year is a deficit year, and this is how the rainfall varies throughout India. This is the rainfall contour, annual rainfall. How much it rains per year? It has a variation. Okay. This is the average, and there is a distribution around the average, right? And now we are here. We are at the second lowest. The first lowest contour is here. This is the desert, Thar Desert. Like you have the Mojave Desert. Here the Thar Desert here, and this is the second lowest. We are in the second lowest contour. So this is to give you a perspective. Okay. Now, what have we been able to achieve? I would like to take you through first two photographs. You know, so in 7 years, you start with a rain-fed farm. You saw where there is no irrigation. It was like this. It took 7 years for us to change it into like this. 3 years ago it was like this, now it is like this. You can see the starting point and the end point. This is done without irrigation, just depending on rainfall, and the rainfall is pretty low. It is not a high rainfall region, and this is possible. Then we felt 7 years is a little long time, no? You don't want to wait for so long. You need to do things quickly. And here is something, this experience, this company, what you are going to see, we were able to do this transformation in 2 years. So initially, Shankar, you can switch off that light. Initially, this was how the land looked like. What you are going to see, when I came in 2010, it was like this. This is how I got it. Then, in 2 years, we made it like this. Okay. In 2 years, we made it like this. there are more pictures what we could do in 2 years. See, this is what you are going to see. And if you, what have we done here? There is a technique called agroforestry. Agro means crops, forestry means trees. See, we, in between rows of trees, we grow crops. So we are combining trees and crops. Why we do that? We will talk about it later. So this is the technique that we do. You see, there are also crops here. You see, crop. There is also tree. So this is what we did. And now you can look at the tree component. The growth is quite high. You can see this growth. Now just to give you an idea, this growth, in about 2 years we were able to achieve about 25 feet, 20 to 25 feet average growth. In India, to get this growth takes about 4 to 5 years. In a temperate climate like US, to get a 25 feet tall growth takes about 15 to 20 years. So we were able to do it in 2 years. So that is how we were able to achieve. We will see all this. Okay. And I was talking about money. I think you are not interested in money. So we will skip this. This is about profit. Again, we will skip all this. I don't think you are interested. And this is not tried just in one place. This is tried in many places in India. You know, these are tried in many places. Many locations in India it has been tried out. Since you don't know India, this slide will not interest you. Okay. This reason, it is not just one, it is tried at many years, you know. There are many places where this has been tried. Okay. We will skip all this. Okay. What I wanted to convey in this is that the rainfed farming is very risky. Okay. How risky is the rainfed farming? Okay, this is something. What we did is, you saw all those farms on the way. You know, you had the figure, you were saying only 35% is irrigated, 65% is not irrigated. Whenever there is no irrigation, these guys have a risk. They may get a profit, they may not get a profit, right? What does the profit depend upon? Rain, isn't it? And rain, as you know, because of the monsoons, is a variable thing. And that is the impact of climate variability, right? And over that, you also have the impact of climate change. Now, what we did was, in order to understand risk, we took 100 years rainfall data and did a simulation model. No? We ran a simulation model of that. Now, they have, if you do simulation modeling, then you get some chances. There is a 60% chance of recovering the cost. In order to grow something, you have to do some investment, right? So the chance of getting your investment back, is less than 60%. 60% of the time, you are not even breaking even. There is no question of profit. So this is a high risk situation. Okay? Then why do they do it? Because 20% of the time, they are able to make a profit which is double the cost. Isn't it? It is like gambling, no? They are trying to gamble for that good year. Thereby they lose a lot of years they lose. Now this is a high risk scenario. So the rainfed farming is a high risk scenario in this region. And that's what I wanted to take. And most of these people are poor people. Those who are gambling are not the rich guys, they are the poor guys. Their holding is less than 5 acres. No? Do you know the holding in US, agricultural farm holding? Can any of you tell me how big are the farms in US? Here, the average holding is about 5 acres. You have an idea how big the farm size is? No, I think it is, 1,000 is the minimum. 1,000, in Australia it is 10,000. Okay, so you know who is, you know the farm size. In Australia it is 10,000. In US, 1,000 is the minimum that you have. So these are poor people and they are taking a risk. We will skip all this because it may have been interesting that, see, this is actual rainfall on x-axis. Rainfall. This is the yield. Now you look at red dots. There is a distribution, right? There is a distribution. There is a, and you will see this is the cost line. Most of the time, the yield is below the cost line. That means they cannot even cover the cost of cultivation. Okay. Now this is the problem of agriculture in India. Most of the time, you don't make money to recover your cost of cultivation. So this is actual data.
Why is the model much more dispersed than the actual?
Sure. See, model is dispersed. It is not dispersed if you take the coefficient of variation, because the amplitude is high. The yields are higher, it appears more dispersed. The variability in the model is less than the reality. It is appearing more simply because of the amplitude. The numbers are high, no? That's why you get that. It's just the numbers. Okay. Now, just to give an idea, since we are on modeling, in the model, our maximum, our average yield is about 1,000 tons per, 1,000 kg per acre, what you can get, okay? 1,000 kg per acre, you can get what you can produce. From 1,000 kg, we can produce here up to 10,000 kg. From 1,000, from 1 ton, you go to 10 tons. From, you can go between 10 to about 30 tons. From 1 ton, it is productivity, depending on the rainfall. In this new method, you can produce almost 10 to 30 times more. And that is how, the because of the increase in productivity, your profits increase. That is the. Now, we will skip all this. This is not very important here. Okay. We will skip all this. This is all about climate risk. We will skip on. Now, I must also tell you, why did I think of this new way of farming as a group? I, with my collaborators, we thought of this new way of farming. Why did we think of this? Then, one fine day, the idea did come to me, let us do a different way of farming. What happened was, over 13 years, we tried all the conventional way of doing research on agriculture, on farming. You know, there is a way in which everybody does. We tried to do that. We did it for 13 years. You know, we did it with some of the best scientists in the world. We had multi-country collaborations. But at that time, we involved participative research. We did multidisciplinary, we did participative, because we had farmers as a part of our research group. We asked them, you know, we did all the right things, and you know, these were some of the things we did, and they are all that we will skip all that. But what is important is, in an applied science, I'm not talking of theoretical science, in applied science, what is the proof that you have done your job well? Your research should get adopted, no? Yeah. See, you are doing work for the farmers. Farmer is your customer. If the customer is not accepting your research, do you think you have done great research? Isn't it? Your customer is not accepting what you have given, right? So if you apply that parameter, most of the time we fail. We did all this supposedly great research. You know, we got papers, we wrote a book and all that. But finally, if you take the success of research, applied research, as adoption by the customer, and the impact it has on the ground, that is how you need to measure it. You know, we actually failed miserably. Okay? And this is what that led us to rethink on the way we should do science and we should do research. Right? That was the motivation for us to think. I mean, before you think that we are bad scientists or bad researchers, you know, this is a proof that we are decent scientists. We have got a number of publications. Yeah, I mean, there are more than that you can find in the So we did research. So this is what I wanted to tell, that good research, good science, if you look at it in my perspective, what you consider as great research does not necessarily mean it has an impact on your customer. It is able to make a difference, isn't it? Yeah. If you take publication as the parameter, we did good. If you take adoption, we failed miserably, right? It is how you evaluate. I mean, I would like to evaluate by actual adoption and not by publications, okay? So one of the things that I chose is I stopped publishing. Now I'm looking more at adoption. I'm trying to see if I'm able to make a difference on the ground. Okay. It doesn't matter if my number of papers decrease, right? So that is how I chose. Somebody else can choose it in a different way, but this is my choice. You just wait for the power to come back. So this was the motivation for me to do this kind of the work. And I will take you through next as to if this particular method of farming, which I call agroforestry, is able to give you such high income, now compared to what others are doing. I will take you through how does it work? How does it work? Why does it give such high income? You know? So I will take you through that. Okay. Similar methodologies, I work with Columbia University on a project of 3 years. Using that, we actually tried this in different parts of India. But this is India and these are all the different parts. I also have experience of trying it in different parts of India through a research project. Okay, now, this is what we are looking at process design principles that I have utilized. Look at the process, look at the design principles. So it is important for you to look at the why part. We come to the why part now. First, this is rainfall. Now you can see rainfall is always a distribution. This is the maximum rainfall. This is the average. This is the minimum. You know, these are different time periods, 13-day time periods. You can see there is a lot of variability. And this is 100 years daily data, average. So you can see maximum, average, minimum. Though it is not rainfall, it is runoff. Runoff is a function of rainfall, right? So I will map runoff. So you can see there is a lot of variability. What happens when it rains? Four things happen. Some of the rain actually runs off, isn't it? It goes off the ground, this is it. Runoff is about that much. Some of it sinks inside the soil, right? It goes deep, and this is the fraction that goes. Some of it evaporates from the soil, and others actually get into transpiration from the plants it passes. Isn't it? Four things happen to the rain. Now, what do we want to do in this? We want to make evaporation and runoff as zero. We want to move to a system where there is zero runoff or zero evaporation. All the water should sink into the ground. Nothing should run off. All the water should not evaporate from the soil. It has to go through the plant roots and become transpiration. Isn't it? So that is what we aim to do. That is the first design principle. When we go there, you will see what do you need for getting more productivity. You need only three things. If you want to increase productivity of the plant, you need light, you need water, and you need minerals. Most of you come from temperate countries. Temperate countries, sunlight is a constraint. You don't have sun, right? Do you have sun in Boston now? Very little sun, right? Okay. Here in tropics, we have huge amount of sunlight. Please remember, tropics is very different from temperate in terms of solar energy we have. So this solar energy, we can harvest it by creating a multi-storied structure. We have trees, tall, then we have shrub, which is 5 feet, 10 feet. We have 30 feet trees, 5 feet, 10 feet shrubs. Then we have 2 to 3 feet herbs. At multiple layers, we can harvest solar energy. Even under 70% shade, crops can grow 100%. So that is the energy that you have in tropics, which is not there in temperate. So I make use of that, I harvest it in multiple layers. Okay? As there are layers in above ground, there are layers below ground also. Roots also become multi-layer. Isn't it? So I create a multi-layered system to harvest solar energy. Okay? So I want to get as much as possible. So this is the first part. The second part is, in tropics, again, the nature is extremely powerful. Okay. Nature works very fast. If you increase the temperature by 10 degrees, the microbial action doubles. You understand? So that is the kind of, it doubles. So as the temperature increases, the nature works very, very fast. Insects grow faster, everything grows fast. The life cycles are faster in tropics. Now we make use of that. What we do is, I will show this principle to you when in the field. We actually provide only the starting point. You provide some nutrients, let us say X nutrients, and then the nature in the tropics takes over. Your X nutrient acts only as a starter, and what you get is 8X or 10X. So the common thing that I say is, here in tropics, 2 plus 2 is not 4, 2 plus 2 is 22. Okay, tropics, this is how it works, 2 plus 2 is 22. Now we make use of this 2 plus 2 by creating what is called virtuous cycles. The nature is able to provide, so we make use of a lot of virtuous cycles in this. How, we will talk about it later. This is a design principle. There is another design principle, the fourth one is called anticipatory design. You know, I have already told you multiple times that there is uncertainty. You don't know, and uncertainty is, what is uncertainty? You don't know what is going to happen, right? Whether it is a high or whether it is a low, you don't know. When you get the high, when you get the low, both you don't know, no? Isn't it? So uncertainty is the major issue. So what is the way to tackle uncertainty? The way to tackle uncertainty is to do anticipatory design. We should anticipate beforehand and design it. So this is called anticipatory design. You cannot start, you know, looking for solutions after the event occurs. You should be prepared beforehand. So anticipatory design we use. So that is the fourth point. Now if you are clear for these principles, we will skip all this and we will go into this one. So now I will take you through how we do this whole process. See, this is the starting point. A land is like this. Agriculture land, this is the farm land that you saw on the way. The land looks like this, isn't it? Now, it can also look like this. What you do is, you start with this trench cum bund. Notice, it is not a continuous trench, there is a separator. And I actually borrowed this from USDA. Many of you have heard that there was Dust Bowl. Have you heard of the Dust Bowl in US? So the Dust Bowl was conquered mostly using this technique of, you know, these are called lock and spill bunds. So it was a very effective technique that USDA developed several years ago, several decades ago. I took that and copied. It is a very effective technique to conserve moisture. We will see it in the field. So this is the basic structure to harvest moisture, lock and spill bund. We make it like this. They can be far away or they can be nearby. It is an element of design. You make them nearby, you can make them far away, and then you fill it with biomass. This was not done by USDA, it is my own addition. You fill the pits with biomass. You don't have to fill green biomass, you know, you can fill anything that you have. You can fill any thorn, any weed, all you need is biomass. You can fill any damn thing, as long as it is able to decompose, you see. Dry sticks, anything you can fill. You fill it up. What happens? When it rains, these pits get filled up. Okay? These pits are made according to the contour. There is a lot of civil engineering that I use. The pits are along the contour lines so that the water distribution, all the pits get full. You will see all this in the field. So, this is how the pits get full. You can see the water actually stagnates in the pit. It becomes clear. Now, we also use larger structures like this. Now you can see, this is the contour, they are along the contour. So this pit, the pits are getting filled everywhere. Okay? And now, where the pits are filled, remember these pits also have biomass in it? Within the water there is biomass. See here, you can plant seeds also, you can plant sticks also. Anything that is available, you plant. Sticks also are planted. Okay? And we raise the seedlings ourselves. So you see, this is how lots of things get planted next to the pit. You see, and they grow like this. This is how they develop. You see, I all remember, there is always tree and next to it is crop. It is never tree alone, never crop alone. You see the mixture? You see, this is how it is developing. You see, and you have to take care of the trees. They can't, they have to grow straight. So he is straightening the trees. So you have to take care. You can grow it in poor land. This is obviously a very bad land. You can do it on any type of land. This is a bad, this is not a fertile land. This is a very poor land. You can do it there also. And you can do it with animals. In India, unlike in the West, animals are free roaming. They are not kept in the shed. Animal, you must have seen, no? Cows on the road, sheep everywhere. So animals are roaming free. There is no restriction. So you can still do it with animals. You don't have to restrict animals. You can do this with animals. Okay. Then, if you do all this, between 3 to 6 years, your rain-fed land looks like this. So this is the end point you want to achieve. Now you see, it is very different from what you started, right? It can look like this. We have got many end points. This is one end point. It can also look like this. These are actual things that we have achieved in the farms. It can look like this. Look like this. These are different farms. You see? It can look like this. Look like this. This guy said, I don't want to grow food. I want to grow fodder. So he has just grown fodder. It is really his choice what they want to do. Okay? So he has grown fodder. Now, this is what you can get per acre, so that individual farmer gets a benefit. This is the way to do it. For a minute now, when you do this method, there are benefits which are larger benefits to the environment, which are beyond the farm. When you follow this method, there are some larger benefits. What is called as transboundary benefit. Beyond this 1 acre, there are benefits. What are those benefits? First is, this method which we follow is completely organic. There are no chemicals used. You don't need chemicals for nutrients. You don't need chemicals for pests and diseases, because there will be no pest, there will be no disease. Can any of you tell me why there will be no pest and there will be no disease? Okay, you will see it in the field. Because you saw, it is completely free of chemicals. That is the first thing. Then you must have heard that it is very diverse in terms of species. So minimum you will have 20 species per acre. You will have a lot of species growing there, and growing a lot of species in one place is very good. Then what happens, if you grow a lot of trees, there is an effect called refugia, where you grow a lot of trees where there are no trees. What happens? All the birds, all the insects, all the frogs come where the trees are there, no? You will have a tremendous amount of diversity, because they have nowhere else to grow, including snakes. They will all come there and stay there.
Oh, I have a question. Like, as you said, if there is a diversity and you have like 20 spaces for a does not it disturb the balance? Like, how do you balance how much water one space can like use, and like other might use more? How do you balance that?
It's great for you. See, the problem is, if all of them demand the same amount of water, you know, the same type of root, it is a problem, because the competition increases. If you have non-overlapping demand, it is to your advantage. If all of you eat, you know, bread, you know, and it's a problem for me if I have less bread. If some of you eat chapati and some of you eat bread, it is easier for me to manage all of you. Okay?
Oh, so it's an advantage.
It is an advantage, not a disadvantage. And we actually want to promote this non-overlapping demand. So more diversity, it is better for me. Okay? We will see how we manage that.
How do you keep the soil healthy while not using fertilizers in active biomass?
Sure, I will show you. Actually, You can see it in the field, but I've got some experimental evidence to show you how fantastically rich it can be without chemicals. Huh? In fact, it is better not to put chemicals. And I've got experimental data to show you how foolish we are to put chemicals into the soil in tropics. Huh? I'm not talking of temperate. Please believe me, you must always caution this. Don't copy paste this to temperate climate. Huh? Okay? Don't go to your university and start doing this. There is a difference in ecology. Okay. Then groundwater recharge. By my method, you are storing a lot of water. A lot of water goes into the groundwater. About 4,000 to 8,000 cubic meter per acre per year sinks into groundwater. Do you know how much is a cubic meter? A cubic meter is 1,000 liters. A lot of 1,000 liters go into the soil and recharges your groundwater. And you understand it's good to recharge groundwater, right? That's what happens. Then soil carbon. All of you have heard of global warming, carbon sequestration. Hey, you have played climate war games, no?
Yes.
All of you know that now if you sequester carbon, you know they would pay money for you. There is something called carbon credits, right? Now, if you put biomass into soil, what happens? The biomass becomes soil carbon. Soil carbon has a permanence. It can stay for 150 to 2000 years. So you are locking carbon as soil carbon, so you can get a lot of carbon credits for this. So you are also helping the environment by locking up soil carbon. So these are the other effects of this method, you know. So there are also larger impacts. Okay, this is the experiments. Now all of these things are supported by scientific experiments. We have got data, we have got measurements to do this. Now, in fact, this is the experimental design. They were done with replications and all that standard treatment, replication, statistical analysis, just followed all that. I forgot your name.
Thurston.
Thurston. Oh, fine, I'll not get it. The red shirt. It's easier. The red t-shirt asked us a nice question. How do you get nutrients if you don't apply chemicals, right? Okay. To answer that question, this is what is called a nutrient budget. You know, like I said, at the beginning, you applied biomass into the pit. Then you didn't do anything. You didn't apply any chemicals. Now you can do your budget, no? What was your starting point? What is your end point? Isn't it? That is what I have done. 2002, we analyzed what was the nutrient status. Okay? And 2006, we analyzed. Okay? Now you remember that your light, these are the most plants require nitrogen, phosphorus, and potassium. Nitrogen, phosphorus, potassium. These are the three things that the plants need. Any plant needs only. These are the three major things. Now you can see, you start with this, you end up with this. With a surplus. Isn't it? You are ending up with a surplus everywhere. Isn't it? Okay. You are ending up with a surplus. Now, where is this nutrients coming from?
The biomass.
Correct. But we actually analyze the biomass. The biomass doesn't have so much of nutrients. And remember, I thought you should remember, we are withdrawing nutrients from the pool because plants are growing, I am cutting the plants and using, that means I am taking out the nutrients, no? It is not a system where you are also withdrawing nutrients. I am harvesting 4 times per year, I am taking out the crop. If you are taking out the crop, you are taking out the nutrients also, no? Isn't it? In spite of that, you end up with a positive biomass. Positive balance. Where does this nutrient come from? I have not put so much of biomass. You know, we actually have proof to show that, but it has not come from biomass. Where has it come from? Okay? So much animals you don't have. Okay? Now, this is where I want to explain 2 plus 2 is 22. Okay? How does it happen? This is the evidence for me saying 2 plus 2 is 22 in tropics. What happens is, this nitrogen is captured by microbes. There are a hell of a lot of microbes. Please don't underestimate microbes. Because they are so small, you think they are useless. the amount, the weight of microbes in the world is 3 times the weight of all the plants in the world. You understand, there are a lot of plants and trees in the world. The microbes weigh 3 times more than them. So there are a lot of microbes, right? Though they are invisible, they are extremely powerful. So a lot of microbes actually capture nitrogen in the air. How much is nitrogen in the air? 70% is nitrogen, right? 78%. All that nitrogen is captured in the air and converted into nutrients and given to the plant. So microbes do that job of bringing nitrogen. Now, phosphorus and potassium, you know, are locked in the soil. A lot of it is present in the soil as minerals. What happens is, soil is nothing but rock. Rock is made of minerals. Minerals contain potassium and phosphorus. They are present in the soil, but they are not available to the plants because they are locked in a chemical form of aluminium phosphate and ferrous phosphate. Okay? So they are locked up. Now, microbes and roots. Roots release acids, microbes release acids. These have a chemical reaction with the locked up phosphorus and potassium, and they make it available to the plant. Isn't it? So, compared to what is available to what is present, from what is present, only 0.02% is in the available form. So 99.88 is locked, unavailable. So there is a huge mountain of nutrients sitting in the soil. You understand? So no need to apply chemicals into the soil. Okay? You just need to convert it into a suitable chemical form. And microbes are there, and you don't have to start a factory to do it. Nature has microbes and roots to do this job. So I just cleverly utilize the microbes and the roots to do this release from the locked chemical form to the available form. That's all you need to do. That is why I said you don't need to apply nutrients, chemical nutrients.
Are the roots that you have that are like supplying the extra nutrients to the soil, are they from additional plants besides that diversity?
Perfect. I grow 75% of the trees to supply nutrient to the 25%. The 25% are the timber ones, which are 10 rupees per kg. So they are my valuable ones. To give nutrients to them, I grow trees which are worth 2 rupees per kg. Isn't it? So I cut also 2 rupees per kg and make them supply to the 10 rupees per kg. Isn't it? That's what we do. So their job is to supply nutrients, nothing else. We will see all this in the field. Okay, this is about moisture, how the moisture increases. We have actually got sensor data, measurements and all. Forget all that. So this is just to say microbes. Compared to control, my microbial population increases. You know, compared to where there is no treatment, this is percentage deviation over control. All types of microbes, fungi, bacteria, actinomycetes, whole kinds of microbes increase. There is a microbe called phosphate solubilizing. It just solubilizes phosphorus. Okay, so all these increase. These are experimental evidence. Okay, this is about root system. We use plenty of roots, so just believe that they were all measured. We will not look into numbers. Okay. Now this is the evidence. See, not just microbes. This is earthworms. You all know earthworms are good. All of you understand that more earthworms means good soil, right? And if in this pit, if you keep your hand, you get earthworms like this, right? So you keep your hand in this pit, you are able to get earthworms like this. Now, if you are able to create all this life and richness, don't you think nutrients will come? That is what we do. Okay? I think I have answered the red shirt's question. Okay. So that's it. So this is what happens. Now, see, the purpose is don't go into data. Just look at the design principles. Now, I will end this part of the experimental evidence. Now, I will say, now all of this I am not interested because the job is over. No. Once you complete all this, this is all my previous work. Now this does not interest me here. I only talk about this to you people to show. But this is not my real interest now. See? See, once you have finished the job, it is no more interesting, right? It is like solving a puzzle. The puzzle doesn't interest you anymore, right? Now, what am I doing now? So, this is about what I am doing now. I'll tell you what is it that I am working on. This doesn't excite me anymore. Okay. So, this is about what I am doing now. Okay. Many of you are in engineers. You know, there are significant. So, I thought I will just present this to you in the systems perspective. In engineering, there is a branch called control systems. There you have system dynamics, because this is all a whole system. We will spend just a few minutes trying to give you a systems perspective in this. See, what have I done? You know, my brain is variable. Because it is variable, I store them as soil moisture. I create a buffer. I create a huge bank of storage. That itself takes the variability out, right? You create a buffer. So that is the soil moisture buffer. Now, because your supply is variable, I want to be clever. Looking at my rainfall probability, I can define the variation into two levels. What is minimum available and what is variable, isn't it? Now, I define the minimum assured component, isn't it? Depending on the rainfall, I have certain volume which is available in the worst case. This is my worst case and this is my variable range. I split the supply of water into two buckets. Minimum, 100% guarantee, partial guarantee, there is a chance. Now, in this 100% guarantee, I pack my most valuable trees, no? My biggest assets depend upon this. The trees. So on this supply, I load the demand of my most valuable stuff. Isn't it? On the variable component, I put less valuable stuff. Isn't it? So this is the design part. I put the less valuable stuff. Huh? And then there is also a design. You should do what is called optimization. You are familiar with optimization? What is the best solution for the given circumstance? Now you look for optimization now. For this you will have to use simulations. Given this soil, given this temperature, given this nutrient, what is the tree that fits best into this? Isn't it? You need to do optimization. So I do that optimization. Optimization for the soil, environment, optimization for the market. What is the guy that gives me the best price? You are very foolish to look at only soil. You should also keep the price in demand, no? So I do an optimization, okay? And we are able to, so this is the whole design part. And this is the systems design that we follow. Now, so this whole thing, please think of it as a dynamic matching of supply and demand. Supply of soil water, supply of soil water, rainfall, runoff, storage. This is the demand of soil water. There is a supply here. How much water you get? There is a demand here. I am trying to balance them dynamically. Isn't it? This is what I do. Just see how I balance. And I mean, you can ask questions in the field. You see, this is what we do. We try to match them. There are a lot of interactions. Okay? This is what we do. This diagram is a little complex, but just see, there is a supply, there is a demand, and there is a lot of feedback. They are talking to each other, and you try to match this dynamically with time. That is what we do. And this is the simplest that I could write it. So this is what happens. So we will, as you are interested, we will talk, and I will be very happy. In fact, this is all the process flow. We will skip all that. And what are the scientific tools that I use? All that is there. How I use simulation modeling. Any of you are interested, we can go through this, but I'll skip. But just to say that all of them have parameters, all of them have modeling. So there is a lot of science and modeling behind this. So we will skip all this. Okay. Now, what is it that I'm interested in? Okay. So what I'm interested in is, I was telling to Devashish in the bus. Now, there are only two kinds of people in the world, the rich and the poor, right? The whole world is divided into this. Now, again, in tropics, I believe I can sell this as a business idea to anybody who is rich. It doesn't matter whether it is Africa, South America, as long as it is tropics, I can sell it to the rich. No, they will buy it. Because that is what I did. I came to the company board, they had 80 acres of land which was useless. I sold this to them as a business idea. Now they are very happy and they are giving me more and more money. That is a sign that they are quite happy with me. Right? Otherwise, why will the company give me more and more? Isn't it? So now I can claim that I have made them happy. Right? Now more and more people are calling me to give money. And now I also took this idea to venture capitalist fund in the Bay Area, San Francisco. So we got enough money to buy about 150 acres nearby. So guys are able to invest. Now they have called me in July to give me more money. I mean, are they fools to give me more money? Again, I mean, they are finding the returns are good. So they are saying, you have done 150, can you do 1,000? So I am coming in July to the Bay Area to talk to them and get more money. Okay. So I am convinced that having done this, we can sell it to the rich. No problem. So the challenge is with the poor. You have heard of the idea of bottom of the pyramid? Right? Now, can you, most of the world is the bottom of the pyramid, or the poor. Rich guys don't make up the world, right? Yeah. So, and bottom of the pyramid tells that there is a business to be done even with the poor, right? Poor are also business worthy. So, how do we work with the bottom of the pyramid? That is the challenge that we have. I am working on that. Okay? The first problem with bottom of the pyramid is that there are too many of them, right? So for a company you can go make a presentation, you know, but with the poor, how do you communicate? How do you reach out? Yeah? There are thousands of them. How do we reach out? So you have to reach out using technology like mobile phones, right? None of them have computers, but all of them have mobile phones. In India, you must know our network is better than the US. In US, here there are very few areas which are not covered by mobile network. That is one. Second, our prices of the mobile are the lowest in the world. You know, however much you talk, your mobile bill does not rise. So India, we have some of the lowest prices. Reach is extremely good. All of them have mobiles. So we want to reach them using technology of the mobile phones. And that is the first part. How do you reach? You want to do that. First is mobile. Second thing is, most of them are illiterate. Please remember, you come from a different society. These guys don't even know their local language. They can't even read it. They just can speak, understand. They can't read or write their own language. You know, it may be alien to you, so they are not literate, even in their own mother tongue. So how do you communicate with them?
Visuals.
It has to be audio-visual. You can't send them a two-page, no. Take my model, it is so great, they will not read it. So you will have to use multimedia communication with them. So that is the second challenge, so we are working on that. Third thing, you know, if I ask you what is your problem, if I ask a company will tell me in 5 minutes what is their problem, right? Many of them are not able to articulate their problem. Please remember this. They know it, not that they are dumb. They don't know how to say it. I am not saying they are not able to recognize. They recognize in their mind, but they are not able to articulate it in the way that you understand. So they also have a problem of articulation. So to understand that problem, many times you have to understand it. So you also need to measure it. You also need data to know what is happening to them, no? Isn't it? So we have used sensors. So from that, to reach to this poor, we made a project called Common Sense. Okay. And this is a project between Indian Institute of Science, me, and EPF Lausanne, Switzerland. So these are the people who are partners. We have been doing this project for 14 years. It's funded by UN. It runs in my farm. What we do is, to help farmers like this, we collect data using sensors. So these are the sensors in the field. We collect data using sensors. The data is processed using simulation modeling. We do data analytics. Okay, and through mobile phone, through multimedia interface, it reaches these farmers. Okay, that is what we are trying to use. So we have sensors in the field, we have analytics, we have a lot of things to collect, and then we give that processed information to them. That is what we do. Now this is my current work.
Yeah. When you say that processed information, are you saying that you're optimizing what each farmer should have?
Yeah, exactly. I'll show you some.
I have a multifaceted question. So the first is, are most farmers subsistent farmers for the most part? So
most
they're working for their family or they're working for profit?
Most of them would love to make profit, but they cannot make profit, so they are at the subsistence level.
So my second question is, why don't you incorporate them into the labor work of your bigger farms such as these?
Yeah, they are doing it. They are doing it. But they do both. See, there is part of the time. See, in India, these people have a portfolio of income sources. They don't have one income source. Part of the income comes from working as labor. Part of the income comes from your own land. Part of the income also comes from small trade. Part of the income comes from animals. You know, here, the poor in India never depend on a single source. They depend on a combination of sources. And each one has its own ingenious combination. So they are already doing that part.
Started testing in the field of giving farmers this process information?
Just wait, I'll show you. So this was what we are trying to do, and this is my current area of work. Just take you through a few slides. Okay, these are the sensors in the field. People who are in computer science and these things know. These are Wi-Fi sensors. They are networked. Using multiple, we use RF, we use Wi-Fi, and then we use all this. Then it goes into the internet, and this is a two-way communication system. We can control each sensor from the internet. Not only the information flow is from the field to the internet, from the internet it can also go to the field. So they are all remote control. So these are the things that we do. And this is the kind of data that you get using all these instruments. You know, it comes, this is soil moisture. This is, I think, blood pressure. This is soil moisture. And when you talk of analytics, you know, data analytics, you were saying for processing. So what does it mean? It means that these are different soil moisture probes. Okay, these are different probes. These are different levels of soil moisture. Okay, these are dates. And you can see there is a big variation between probes. And different, the soil moisture is very different. Now, each of this has a different strategy, different advice. You don't give the, see, you should not give the same advice to this fellow and this fellow, no? Obvious, it is a stupid advice to give, no? So advisors get customized according to your reality in the field, isn't it? These kind of farmers get a very different advice from these kind of farmers. So you should not give stupid advice, you should give smart, customized advice, isn't it? Most of the scientists like to give stupid advice because it is simple to do so. Customization is always difficult. Huh? Customization is not easy. And that is why farmers don't listen to scientists. Because they find the advice stupid. Right? Okay. I can say that because I have done it. So I can say that. And this is a smart thing to do. Customize. And now that you have seen all this, this is how we customize. This is a mobile phone screen. Okay? This farmer, for him, we customize everything to his land. We customize. This is the photo, and you can see all of them are icons. Though he is illiterate, he presses on the icon. Then this is the one. It gives you a voiceover. It has a voiceover. Since it is a voiceover, it is all Android-based programming. And this voiceover can be in any language. It can be in Hindi, English, or Spanish. If you want Chinese, it can be in that. Mandarin, fine. So anything. So it is just changing your audio file, right? No, BB in Android programming. So to do that, and all of this is done by students. So I have worked on these things. We have had 3 PhDs and 5 MTechs. You know, so a lot of people have worked on this, and most of them are developed by students and from EPFL. So these are the kits, and from IITs also we have had, and this is what they did. And customization, all of this. So this is what that interests me. More menus. All of them have, if you press on the icon, it will give you the voiceover. Okay. So this is it. So not only that, we have also thought, then we thought, all of you love Facebook, right? What is so great about Facebook? You can learn a lot from your peers, sir. See, nobody likes advice. You like to learn from somebody who is good. So this is like the Facebook for farmers. So you learn, this guy learns from him, this guy learns from him. So they learn from each other. Obviously, the first thing they asked us is, come on, sir, you don't try to tell us everything, you don't even know our situation. Let us, that guy is a very smart farmer. Tell me what he's doing. I mean, you don't tell me. Tell me what that smart guy is doing, right? Isn't it? So these smart guys now talk to each other. They learn from each other. So we have created that exchange platform where they learn from each other, isn't it? Why do you want to listen to somebody outside here? He doesn't even understand what is going on. So this is what we did. We created this. More like this. You see, they are talking to each other. This is a pest called leaf miner. If a pest comes, in real time, they are able to talk to each other. How is this guy handling the pest? How is this guy handling the pest? This icon says, you know, you can actually phone him. If you're pressing, the phone call will go to him. You can actually talk to him now. No need to write anything. So this is directly go and talk to him and we do that.
Are these guys, say for any situation where you have multiple people, are they separated by geographically, how far away would they be?
Yeah.
In the same state?
They, as of now, please remember, see, those of you who know programming, this is still in the beta stage. You know, it is very easy to do a program, but it's a very pain when it gets, when you have to debug it. Isn't it? It's nice to write, it is the good part. The bad part is to debug it. And you will go wrong for 100 reasons, right? Huh? So we are in the beta testing. So once you are able to test it, it doesn't matter if it is 1,000 or 100,000, right? For an automated system, your computation is not the constraint, isn't it? So either this 1,000 or 10,000, 100,000 doesn't matter, right? So we are in the debugging stage, so which is a very painful stage, okay? Okay, nobody likes to debug their own programs, much worse somebody else's programs, right? Isn't it? That's it, we are at that stage. And see, you work with students, the student goes away, right?
Yeah.
Do you think? So that's the bad thing about students. They don't remain as students, no, they go away. Okay, that's all. So we are in that stage. This is just to tell you how... okay, many things we learn from each other. There is also a database that gets created. Okay, and now this is the part that I am working on. Now, I think I want to stop here. Okay, it is kind of a little more than what I wanted to pay. So now, what I would want you to do is